Yes.
Okay. So this is a trip that my mom and I took, and she kind of took it out of the blue and said, "Hey, I want to go to Kenya." As if, you know, theoretically, would you ever want to go to Kenya? And I said, "Sure." And she said, "All right, we're going this summer." And that's kind of the story. But basically, we went with a small group of 8 people, so myself and my mother included. It was a 12-day trip when we left from LAX, and we flew to Amsterdam, and then flew to Nairobi, which is the capital. So, again, we went with 6 other people, most notably Justin Rudd, who is the leading author.
Shirt, pants are short, and then a sweater on top.
but most of these kids can't afford to purchase new sweaters or new shoes, which is why many of them are barefoot. And in fact, one of the more depressing stories about this was the fact that when we went to Mombasa, which is the coastal city, there were a lot of kids who were out of school because they owed school fees. So our team leader, Justin, he brought a couple of these kids, about seven kids, paid off their fines, and then the next year for tuition. And in total, that cost them $12. But most of these people make only about $2 a day. And when they have, multiple children and then food to worry about, they can't necessarily pay off tuition. So they're working with debt as well as 50 cents, but they want more tuition because of that. Then on the right hand side, these were trade school kids. So they had an option of, instead of going to college, they can take it to trade school. And so the girl up on top was making a skirt, and the boys at the bottom were looking to become mechanics. But most of the time, the classrooms are very bare. It consists of a small concrete room, probably about a quarter size of this room, and it's cement floor, but more affordable schools can only just have a dirt floor with a chalkboard that's pretty old and outdated. And they'll fit about anywhere from 30 to 60 kids in one room. So in terms of having the facilities to learn, it's very difficult and it's very minimal. But one of the schools that we visited was actually funded through the organization itself, through my meeting. And this was the girls' high school, and it's about six or seven buildings of a decent size, but it's still a very bare school. Up in the top is what their cafeteria was. So they have about 300 girls, and they make food through these large vats, and they chop the firewood through here, and they're planning on extending. But it's a very, very clean school. Overall, they were all in testing. At the moment, we didn't have the opportunity to meet them, but we did donate school supplies and met with the faculty. So the average teacher in Kenya makes about $12 a month. And so many of these faculty members at the school are very dedicated to the kids. One of the nice things that we got to do was we took the kids from the school and a couple others on a safari. So we had three buses with the kids, and we bought them lunch, and they went on about a 6-hour safari. And some of the things that we saw here, saw lions, zebras, a water buffalo. There were ostriches and giraffes, among other things as well. So this is actually my favorite aspect of the entire trip, which was when we went to a church. And it's very simple, as you see, but it was an entirely song, bilingual experience. It was in Swahili and English. It was a lot of dancing, it was a lot of fun, and it really proves that what I said up there, they didn't need translation. People were happy, and I think that was something that's really remarkable, is that despite having so little, these people managed to just smile bright and keep their future so optimistic. Another thing that we got to do on this trip was we got to help build a home for this girl here. Her name is Sugoni, and basically, her father has to work in another town here several miles away. So it's not from home, it's just her home. But she's mentally ill, and family and has these seven children, it basically was the one year life for her entire family. So we spent the time helping to carry bricks, my mom brought water, as you can see in the photo, and we got to talk to the kids a little bit. And it was a very, very heartwarming experience. So another thing that we did was part of the cost of going on this trip was the safari, but also we bought livestock for families that needed it. So all over, throughout Kenya, there are many goats and cows and chickens just wandering across the road. And for many of these people, this is a major source of not only food, but income if they sell eggs or milk or the actual animal itself. So we bought 5 goats and 2 dairy cows, and then later on we bought 5 chickens for that girl that we were going to hunt for as well. So when we go on these trips to the home, if the family could afford it, they'd actually try to give us eggs, despite having very little. They'd try to give back as a thank you. And so those eggs are some of it, but also the coconut I was drinking from in that photo was actually some of away from the tree, of the palm tree, and cut them down for us. And then I was given this flower by a girl in the village. I mean, overall, Kenya, we get this image of Kenya, I feel like, as kind of this massive savanna and, you know, things like this, but it's a really vibrant place. It's very green on the coast. It's beautiful, and it was winter, even though it was like 85% humidity, but it was a beautiful place, and it's vibrant, it's lively, it's truly a wonderful place if you ever have an opportunity.